Welcome to the second part of this tutorial series where we're using Photon Fusion 2 to build a multiplayer game in Unity. In this video, we'll be implementing a proper game loop that includes determining the winner, starting and restarting the game when all players are ready, and displaying players' progress on a leaderboard. Let's get right into it. This blue platform will function as our finish line, and to make it possible for players to reach it, I'm going to set up a few platforms using the block prefab. Next, we need to be able to detect when a player actually reaches the finish platform. To do this, attach a second box collider to it, set it to be a trigger collider, and adjust its size and position so it sits nicely on top of the platform. Then in the GameLogic class, create a networked property that stores which player won the game. Add a GameState enum and a second networked property which stores the current game state. Next, we'll override the spawned method and use it to initialize the two properties. In the onTriggerEnter method, we'll first check if this is running on the host player, as we only want the host to decide who won. We'll also check if no one has won yet, and we'll check if the object that entered the collider has a rigid body attached to it. If all those things are true, we'll retrieve the other object's player component if it has one. Inside this if statement, we'll set the winner and update the game state. Over in the player class, add a bool to keep track of whether or not the player is ready. This doesn't have to be a network property, as the host is the only one that needs to know about its value. We'll be using it to wait for all players to be ready before we start or restart the game. Back in the GameLogic class, add a method that loops through all the connected players and resets their readiness. Then call this method from onTriggerEnter when someone has won the game. Next, override fixedUpdateNetwork. Inside, we'll loop over all the players and check each one's readiness. If anyone isn't ready, we can set rAllReady to false. If rAllReady is still true after the loop, we'll reset the winner, update the game state, and call preparePlayers, which is a method that doesn't exist yet. Add two transform references, one for the spawn point and another for the position around which the spawn point will pivot. We'll use these to spawn players in a circle at equal distances from each other. Next, create a method that will return the next spawn position when called, based on a given angle for the spacing between players. Now create the preparePlayers method. Here we'll calculate the spacing angle, give the spawn point pivot a random starting rotation, and loop through all the players, teleporting each one to their spawn point. Since the player class doesn't have a teleport method, create that now. It just needs to set the KCC's position and rotation. Back in Unity, create the SpawnPointPivot object with the SpawnPoint object as its child. Don't forget to assign them to the GameLogic scripts fields. Next, we need to set up some UI logic, so create a new UI manager script. Open up the CameraFollow class, copy the singleton-related logic, paste it into the UI manager, and replace the CameraFollow references with UI manager ones where necessary. Then add two TextMesh Pro UGUI references. We'll use these to give the player information about who won and what to do next. Create a new setWaitUI method, inside which we'll set the UI text based on the game state and who the winner is. At this point, if we want to display the winner's name, we need players to actually have names, so head over to the player class and add a network property to store the player's name. The Fusion menu system stores the player's username in player prefs, so in the spawned methods has input authority check, we'll grab that stored value and set the name property to it. Then we're going to invoke an RPC to send our username to the host player. RPC stands for Remote Procedure Call, and they basically allow you to ask other network peers to execute a method with certain parameters. While they're very convenient, RPCs do have certain drawbacks, so you don't just want to use them everywhere. For example, players who join after the RPC was invoked, or players who disconnect and reconnect, will have no idea that the RPC ever happened. This means that if your RPC affects game state in any way, that effect should be recorded in a network property. If that's confusing, our player name RPC should help to explain it better. Inside, we're simply going to set the name property to the name parameter. Since the name property is networked, this means that we've recorded the RPC's effect in a way where it remains part of the network state. We're only using the RPC to tell the host what our username is, and then the host stores that in the network name property. From there, it will be properly synchronized to everyone else that's connected, regardless of whether they joined late, disconnected and reconnected, or have been connected all along. To make this RPC actually work, two things are critical. The first is that the letters RPC need to be part of the method name, either as a prefix or a suffix. The second is that we need to give this method the RPC attribute. We'll set RPC sources to input authority to only allow the RPC to be triggered by players with input authority, and we'll set RPC targets to state authority to ensure the RPC is only executed on the host. Now we can go back to our UI manager and include the winning player's name in the title text. Then we just need to enable or disable the text fields based on the current game state. Finally, we need a method to update the UI accordingly when the player indicates that they're ready. We still need to make it possible for players to actually indicate their readiness somehow, so we'll do that using another RPC. In the player class, add an RPC setReady method. Inside, we'll set isReady to true, and if we have input authority, we'll also update the UI to inform the player that they've set themselves as ready. In this case, we want to allow the RPC to be triggered by input authorities and executed on both state and input authorities, so that the UI update is actually allowed to run locally when the player indicates their readiness. By default, RPCs will be executed locally on the peer that triggers it, assuming the RPC target's value allows it. We're going to use the R key to indicate readiness, so our input manager will need a reference to the local player so it can call the RPC on it. We'll set this reference from the player's spawned method. Luckily, we can easily access the input manager because it's attached to the network runner. Now in the input manager, create the reference to our local player. Then in before update, we'll check if the R key was pressed and if the local player exists, in which case we'll call our setReady RPC. Again, this is an appropriate use case for an RPC as the only effect it has is on a variable which only the host cares about, so late joiners or anyone who reconnects isn't missing anything by not being connected when the RPC is invoked. In the GameLogic class's player join callback, we can also make use of our new getNextSpawnPoint method instead of just spawning players at the world origin when they first connect. We also still need to make use of our UI manager's setWaitUI method, so let's do that. To invoke this when the game state changes, we can simply add the onChangedRender attribute to the network game state property. This attribute will cause Fusion to check for changes to the property in the render callback, meaning it should only really be used for visual stuff and not to execute simulation-related logic. We just want to update some UI, which is a fine use case for it. If you want to run simulation-related logic based on state changes, you should use Fusion's ChangeDetector API to detect changes from fixed update network instead. We won't be doing that in this video, but if you're interested and want to read more about it, there's a link in the description. Let's also make sure to update the UI from the spawned method. Finally, we need to fix something I missed earlier. In the fixed update network method, we only want to restart the game if it isn't currently running, and only the host needs to do this, so everything aside from the first if statement should be inside an if statement that checks those conditions. In Unity, attach the UI manager to the UI game object, and then assign the waiting UI's children to the text references. If you run the game now, you should see the UI update properly. Pressing R should teleport you to a spawn point and hide the UI, and reaching the finish platform should tell you that you won. All of this should also work with a second or even multiple other clients connected. Next, we're going to set up a leaderboard so we can see which player is closest to reaching the top. In our UI manager, add an array of leaderboard items. Then create the leaderboard item struct, which will just hold references to the text fields for each player's name and height. This struct needs to be serializable so we can assign the references in the inspector later. Next, create a method which takes an array of player key value pairs. Inside, we're going to loop through the leaderboard items and set their name and height fields for each player. If the player's array is shorter than the leaderboard items array, we'll set the name and height of the extra items to empty strings. Over in the player class, let's add a property that returns the player's height as the score. I'm going to round this to one decimal place, but if you prefer to round to the nearest whole number, just replace the one with a zero. Then in the GameLogic class's fixed update network method, we're going to update the leaderboard. Typically, you would do UI updates from the render callback, but since players only move in fixed update network, I decided it made sense to also update the leaderboard from there. However, on clients, fixed update network is invoked multiple times per tick because Fusion automatically rewinds the simulation when state is received from the server, and then it resimulates back up to the present. Updating our UI during client resimulations is completely unnecessary, so we'll add a check to make sure we are currently not in a resimulation. In the if statement, call the UI manager's update leaderboard method. We'll use link to sort the player's dictionary by score and then convert it to an array. This will allocate a new array every time, so it's a bit inefficient, but in our situation we're doing it infrequently enough that it isn't really an issue. By default, Fusion only invokes callbacks like fixed update network on scripts whose network objects have either state or input authority, and on non-host clients, our GameLogic class has neither of those. To make sure our UI actually gets updated on all clients, we can manually tell Fusion to invoke the fixed update network method and other callbacks by setting the GameLogic's network object to be simulated. This line is also what makes the runner.isServerCheck necessary down in fixed update network, because without it, the GameLogic class's fixed update network method would never even be invoked on clients. Back in Unity, make sure to assign all of the leaderboard text fields to the UI manager's leaderboard items array. If you run the game now, you should see the leaderboard updating with the player's vertical positions as their score. Finally, we're going to address an issue with our current mouse input sampling logic. You may have noticed that the camera movement is not completely smooth, although how obvious that is somewhat depends on your frame rate, monitor refresh rate, mouse polling rate, and how all of those interact. If you're interested in reading about this further, there's a link to this documentation page in the description. With my setup, the jitter becomes quite visible if I move sideways around a stationary object while keeping the camera pointed roughly at it. Properly fixing this problem ourselves is a bit out of the scope of this tutorial series, but luckily for us, a recent update to the Fusion KCC packages introduced a utility which can do the heavy lifting for us. The first thing we need to do is to update the KCC packages. If you downloaded the starter project before this video was published, you'll need to do this, but if you downloaded it after this video was published, then it should already contain the updated packages, and you can skip this step. You can find the latest KCC packages on the Photon website. Download them, return to Unity, and delete the KCC and Simple KCC folders in the Fusion Add-ons folder. Then import the downloaded packages from the Assets, Import Package, Custom Package menu. Once both packages are updated, open the Input Manager class. Inside, add a Vector2 Accumulator field with a smoothing window of 0.025. You can play around with this value a bit if you like. Smaller values will result in less extra input delay, but the input will also be smoothed less. Something in the range of 0.01 to 0.025 is usually a good starting point. Then down in the before update method, replace the accumulated input.lookDelta assignment with a call to our new accumulator's accumulate method. In the onInput callback, we'll call the consumeTickAlign method and assign the result to the accumulated input's lookDelta. This internally resets the accumulated mouse input as necessary, which means we can also remove the line below, which resets the lookDelta. If you were to test it at this point, you may notice that your mouse movement feels a bit sluggish. This is because we are currently setting the camera rotation based on the KCC's interpolated look rotation, which effectively adds a whole tick's worth of delay to our mouse input. Fortunately, Fusion's KCC is capable of predicting the look rotation, so we're going to set that up as well to get rid of the unnecessary delay. For this to work, we'll need to be able to access the current accumulated mouse input, so we'll add a property to expose that. Then in the player class, add a reference for the input manager and a vector2 to store the latest tick's look rotation. In the spawn method, assign the result of the getComponent call to our new input manager reference. We'll also enable the KCC's force predicted look rotation setting. Make sure this is inside the check for input authority, as we don't want to attempt to predict other players' rotations. At the end of the fixed update network method, we need to update the base look rotation. Finally, in the render method, we'll check if the predicted look rotation setting is enabled, and if it is, we'll calculate the predicted look rotation from the base look rotation and the accumulated mouse delta since the last tick. Make sure to apply the predicted look rotation using the setLookRotation method, not with addLookRotation, since this is not a delta value. If you run the game now, your mouse movement should be smooth and jitter-free, but it should also still feel snappy and responsive. And that's it for this video. In part 3, we'll be implementing more advanced movement mechanics, including grappling and gliding. Don't forget to like and subscribe, and I'll see you in the next one.